Hey everybody, Frank Spear back with you. Want to do a video today on two things: patterns and time signatures. So let's start with time signatures. A lot of people confused about time signatures, how to play in odd time signatures, odd meters, odd time, right? So in Western music, pop music, typically we're used to hearing things in 4-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1. It's all about where the placement of the one is. So if you got, you know, 1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2, you feel that beat. 1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3, right? That's normal to us. 3 or waltz time, 1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3. We drop the beat there, right? So you get a different feel there. Rum dum 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 dum. 1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4. Right? Say you just keep carrying that on. Watch the strength of the one. 1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4. So in typical like rock driving beat, the drummer would be sure to smack that one, hit a cymbal crash on one or something, let everybody know where we're starting that beat over again, right? Or that bar over again. 1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5. Create a riff or a lick inside of that beat. 6-1-2-3-4-5-6-1-2-3-4-5-6-1-2-3-4-5-6. Now, of course, the tempo can change. 1-2-3-4-5-6-1-2-3-4-5-6-1-2-3-4-5-6-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5. That's the feel of the song. A band like Yes, a band like Rush, are very good at using these time signatures in ways that still sound pleasant to the ear. Right? You almost don't know that a part is in 5 or a part is in 7. Rush uses 5, 6, 7 all the time. Now, you've got like 6. Let's do it this way. Let's keep going so I don't get ahead of myself. Let's try 9, right? You very rarely hear anything in 9. But you've got 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9, 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9, 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9, 1-2-3-4-5-6-9, bantum dugadubadum dum bantum dugadugadentum. So you can write licks and listen to like 1970s Bill Bruford albums, like One of a Kind, or I can't think of the names of them now, but I think there's one called Hell's Bells. Not Hell's Bells, that's an AC/DC tune, but something like that. Go listen to 1970s Bill Bruford with Jeff Berlin on the albums and Holdsworth. You'll hear all those weird time signatures like 9, 13, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 1. Everybody in the band's got to know where that one is and where we're repeating the riff, right? Coming back at the one. Now, an easy way to do that is subdivide. Like, if I was counting 9, I wouldn't necessarily count. Like, let's say we had a riff in a song that was like a... Let's just do 3 threes. And, you know, 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9. 1-2-3-4-5-6-7-8-9. Right? And we were playing it fast. Like... That's it. I might subdivide it into a bar of 5 and a bar of 4. So I might count it like 1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4. Or you can count it 1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3-1-2-3. You can count it 3 bars of 3 and just subdivide it however it helps you. But I might count it 1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-5-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4. And if I'm jamming a song and I'm doing all, now it gets harder, believe it or not, when you're not playing a note on every beat, right? So here's 9 in a drum beat. Let me start it over. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So when you start doing that bump, 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 playing music like that and trying to keep that nine in your head, gets difficult. But here's the point. Somebody might be asking, why? Why would you do this? Well, a lot of world music plays in these odd time signatures. Music from all over the world, or Brazilian music or Asian music. African rhythms. They're not in four. So they would sound odd to us, right? Everything for us is... One, two, three, four. We've got those, that backbeat, you know, and even if it's slow, it's still 1, 2, 3. That was three. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? We're so used to four that when we hear five, 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's put five on here on the drums and see what five sounds like if we put a little chord progression to it. Give me a sec. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. See, right away it's like, but that's so cool, right? Because if you come up with a cool lick to play over five, if people get used to it, they can start to feel five, then it becomes something special. Like if we had something like... It's so cool because it's out of the ordinary for us, right? This focus thing drives me crazy. It's out of the ordinary for us. It makes our ear go, ooh, what's that? I can't feel it in my body quite as well as I feel music normally. A lot of times, like bands like Rush or Yes, they're playing in four most of the time, but they'll throw in a bar of five, a bar of six, a bar of seven, or a lick that's based on those time signatures. So you may get something like Free Will from Rush, like one, two, three, four, five, six. They're in six there. Let's listen to that song. Hold on a second. Okay, so if memory serves me well, this song opens with a lick in seven, and then it goes into a little six pattern. Let's see if we can, if I'm right, we can count it. I think it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, then it goes into 6. Let's see. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3. Hold on, try it again. Even there it changes. Is an extra beat in there. But see how cool it is? But if I didn't say that, check out the 70. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Then into 6. So you got bands like Rush and Yes and many others, especially the progressive rock bands of the 70s, doing that really kind of cool stuff. So hopefully that helps you a little bit with what we could talk. We could keep going and look at examples. even on my album, which I'll put a link to down here, we've got a song called Burn You Down, based on the movie Tombstone. And it's based on the character of, not what's his name? Doc Holliday and Johnny Ringo. And there's a line that says, touch that gun and I'll burn you down, I think. So I wrote the lyrics based on that. But check that out. That's got bars of five in it. And see if you can find where the five is, because it kind of still grooves. It swings within the context of the song. I wanted to talk next about patterns a little bit. And like even this beginning of this Rush song, this is a pattern. It's very pattern-based. Now, I don't remember that pattern, but those are the wrong notes, but you get it. It's just, there's an... It's a scale of some sort, and you're going down a few notes, then repeating a few notes and creating patterns. Like, here's an example of the major scale, and I'll show you what I'm doing. And patterns are endless, and this is how you create cool licks, cool solos, right? That was A major, right? But if I start, if I go, got sloppy at the end there. But you see my point, I'm playing some kind of pattern there to prolong the scale, right? So if I break that up into little chunks, I'm going like, I'm playing the first four notes, then starting from the next note down, I'm playing the next four notes down. So imagine, it's not very musical, right? Like that, but if you got a band, you're going. Especially if everybody's doing that stuff in unison. So there's no end to the patterns you could do. If I take, for example, G minor pentatonic, and I go down in fourths, I get that sound. So again, right? You could write tons of stuff out of the, like. Now you generally won't hear really weird phrasing like that in pop music because they don't want to take any chances of messing with the money, right? So if there's something really funky sounding or bizarre in a solo or something, or even in a melodic phrase, if singers are singing that way. Imagine if there's a, let's say, for example, there's a tune, let's play A. And your vocal line is. Actually, that's kind of cool. So you now, what if we take fifths, right? We took fours. Take fifths. Mm-hmm. sixth with sevens. Right? There's no end to it. Play patterns, going back to patterns. Let's take a three-note pattern or a six-note pattern. Doesn't matter, I'm just playing anything. There are countless ways to subdivide that up, right? Or to divide it up. Like we could play, instead of one, three, four with the fingers, instead of one, three, four, we could play one, four, three, one, four, three. So instead of, we get, that's how you get patterns like, messing with a scale and a little piece of a scale and getting patterns out of it. What if we go simple, right? Backwards. So we go 4-3-1, 4-3-1. So far we could go. Write a lick where you use all three. Right? So you start. Right? I mean, it's endless. We could go 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean, that's a rock lick. Then move it up a string set. I forgot what I even did. Right? So, I mean, it's endless writing songs like that. People always think chords when they write songs. I gotta play chords. I mean, chords can be really awesome. But how about writing licks? Like the old days when people wrote licks, you know? To me, licks are cooler than chord progressions. Take chord progressions and make licks out of them. Let me take a simple example of the 1-4-5 chord progression in A. Write licks instead of chords. So I got my one chord is my A major. My two chord here in this is the four chord, right? Is the D major and E major. So what if I write a lick, A major first, and then repeat that lick. That's cool. It's cooler. What if you change the lick every time to something different? Right? Remember, like, just a couple of notes. Yes, there's a chord there, but that's so memorable, right? Doesn't that beat the hell out of... Right? This is an E chord, right? He's taking the B, which is the fifth, and the seventh, the dominant seventh of E. Two notes sliding into the third note, or the chord, right? So you got three notes there. How How simple is that? Now, if I were sitting around here going, I'm going to write a hit song, a classic, a legendary piece of music, rock music, that people are going to be talking about for 50 years, 100 years, 200 years. I got these three notes. What can I do? Then it's all what we're going to do vocally over that, right? What comes next? So you got, you need fooling, right? I can't sing that high. So it all depends on what you do with your vocal line too on top of that, right? We could play the simplest chord progression. If I play a... that same chord progression we were just playing. Big deal, right? That's nothing. Doesn't sound like anything special. But if I put a great melody over the top, right? I figured out a great melody and I sing, don't start that talking. I could talk all night. My mind is sleepwalking while I'm putting, whatever the next chord is. I think it changes chords there. But don't start that talking. I could talk all night. I mean, that's gold. So right away, I transformed the simple little three-chord thing into Elvis Costello tune, Oliver's Army. We could give a million examples of that same chord progression, literally thousands upon thousands of examples. Baby, oh baby, let me be your loving teddy bear. We can go back to the Elvis days, right? It's, he took that again and... That's all right for you. That's all right, mama. Said it's any way you do. And that's all right. That's all right. That's all right now, mama. Any way you do. So it all depends on what you do with it. Back to these patterns a little bit. They're endless, like I said before. And if you take a major scale and you say, I'm going to play 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. I'm going to play 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4 out of it. Right? You do it with fives. You could do it with sixes. You could do it in fifths. You could do it in fourths. You could do it in thirds. You could do it in sevenths. You can do it backwards, reverse order. You could do some one reverse, one forward, one reverse, one forward. Right? You could skip strings. Oh, that's a tough one. Right? You can do... you could do it, skip a string, one reverse. That's too hard. Play wide intervals, right? So if you're playing a solo or writing a melody, you instead of going... go. Right? Start a solo like this. Right? Right? Play some big jumps in intervals. You know, create a lick like that. Think of something like the beginning of, well, you know, whatever that Welcome to the Jungle song is. Which is, I'm not a big fan of, but hey, don't hate me for it. But that lick in the beginning there, I think it's that song. Actually, I think I'm thinking of Sweet Child of Mine, that opening guitar lick, which I used to know. I'm terrible with keeping things in my memory. If I learn a song, I can learn almost any song. If I learn it and I don't play it every day or every couple of days and a month goes by, I don't know what the hell I did. I'm like, where was that again? I've never been good with retention. even my own songs. I write albums worth of material. And if you ask me a year from now, play me a piece of a song from your album. I don't know. I have no idea. I have to go back and listen and relearn it myself. So I'm terrible. I have friends that never forget anything. You ask them to play licks from any tune, they go through the whole tune. It's like, wow, how do you do that? I was never good at that. But anyway, these patterns, and you know, they sound faster, cooler, faster or slower. Do it like getting back to them. If we got these patterns. Those sound cooler. Like Al Di Meola looks like that. Do them legato. Right? You can do them. I don't have a really distorted sound here, but. Right? There's no end to what you can do with patterns. So take a pattern and sit down and try to develop a classic rock lick out of it. Right? Skip strings. Even that right there, I mean, that's a classic rock lick. It just came up with it right there. You picture this. I'm gonna steal that off myself, man. Anyway, that's it for today. Hope you guys enjoyed it. See you next time.